Welcome to part one of diabetes mellitus. This PowerPoint is going to focus on the anatomy and physiology of diabetes. As far as objectives, the student will differentiate between type 1 and type 2 diabetes. The student will describe the diagnostic criteria for diabetes, and the student will discuss the treatment modalities for diabetes, including injectable and oral medications. Diabetes mellitus is a group of diseases characterized by hyperglycemia caused by the defects in insulin secretion, insulin action, or both. Diabetes affects nearly 34.1 million people in the United States, but sadly, almost one-third of the cases are undiagnosed, which has major implications on the healthcare system. If diabetes is not controlled, people have major complications that could include amputations, blindness, kidney failure, heart attacks, and it could potentially turn into life-threatening complications. It's actually the eighth leading cause of death in America, and they think that might be underreported. There are three main types of diabetes: type 1, type 2, and gestational. Type 1 diabetes, which we used to call juvenile diabetes or insulin-dependent diabetes. Type 2 diabetes, which used to be called adult onset diabetes or non-insulin dependent diabetes. We're going to discuss each one of them on their own in future slides. Gestational diabetes is hyperglycemia during pregnancy, and we do not discuss this at all in block 1. Prediabetes is elevated glucose levels that are not high enough to be considered diabetes. In people who do not get those blood glucose levels under control, it will most likely turn into diabetes. Before we get into diabetes, let's talk about insulin and why it's important. Insulin is a hormone secreted by the beta cells in the pancreas. Insulin is secreted by the beta cells in response to rises in blood glucose levels after eating. Insulin is responsible for many things in the body, but the most important thing that it does is move the glucose from the blood, and it pushes it into the cells so the cells can use the glucose for energy. In addition, insulin stimulates the liver and muscle cells to store glucose in the form of glycogen for later use. It tells the liver to stop releasing glucose when more is not needed. It accelerates transport of amino acids into the cells, and it inhibits the breakdown of stored glucose, protein, and fat. All of these things allow the cells to function properly and allows for backup sources of glucose for energy if the body doesn't have a steady source of glucose or they don't have a steady source of food. The pancreas also secretes a small amount of insulin in times when we're not eating, and this is called basal insulin. The pancreas also secretes a hormone called glucagon from the alpha cells, which stimulates the liver to release stored glucose when the body needs some energy and it isn't getting enough food. Insulin and glucagon work together to keep our blood glucose level in a constant, even state level. Now that we know what insulin is and why it's important, let's talk about type 1 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is more common in young people, usually less than 17 years old, which is why we used to call it juvenile diabetes. In type 1 diabetes, all of the beta cells in the pancreas have been destroyed. They do not work at all anymore. This can be caused by genetics, immunological issues, and environmental factors like viruses. I need to mention that diabetes itself is not genetic, but there does seem to be some genetic susceptibility or predisposition that makes some people more likely to develop type 1 diabetes. There is also some autoimmune response components of type 1 diabetes. Some viruses like mumps, cytomegalovirus, rotavirus, and even germinal measles have been shown to have effects on people getting type 1 diabetes. Regardless of how the beta cells get destroyed, the destruction causes decreased insulin production and increased glucose production by the liver, both of which cause hyperglycemia, and the cells do not get the glucose they need to survive because there's no insulin to push the glucose into the cells. This hyperglycemia sets off several issues in the body. The kidneys can't reabsorb all of the glucose, so they start to pee some of it out, called glycosuria. Glucose is a very large molecule, like protein, and it can cause kidney damage. glucose and water are friends. So when we pee out glucose, they're also peeing out a lot of excess fluid. And we call this type of excess fluid and electrolytes that they're losing a type of osmotic diuresis. Since the cells think they're starving to death, the fat storage is broken down for energy, causing increased production of ketones, which are a byproduct of fatty metabolism. This all occurs in the body really quickly, with people going from just fine to critically ill in just a couple of days. You can see a healthy 2-year-old child that tries to die 36 hours later. It is that fast. If it's left untreated, all of these issues can cause a life-threatening condition called DKA, which is diabetic ketoacidosis, and that is an emergency situation that you will talk more about in block 3. Type 2 diabetes is more common in adults, like people over the age of 30, although we're seeing it in younger and younger people in America. Unlike type 1 diabetes, the beta cells are not fully destroyed. There's impaired insulin secretion, but it's not completely stopped. There is also insulin resistance in the cells, meaning the cells do not allow the insulin to push the glucose inside the cells. They don't know exactly why all of this occurs, but they think there is a genetic component that predisposes people to type 2 diabetes. They also know that diets that are high in carbs and sugar increase the cells' resistance to insulin, and that type of diet is very common in America. With the cells resistant to the insulin, the pancreas tries to secrete more insulin to help push that excess glucose into the cells. The beta cells can't keep up with this high demand, so the glucose level keeps rising. The GI tract starts to absorb extra glucose because the cells think they're starving. So they're telling the body, hey, I need more glucose, except the blood has too much glucose. The cells don't have the glucose. And type 2 diabetes is slowly evolving in the body. It's not a quick disease like type 1 diabetes. In type 2 diabetes, there's enough insulin production to not allow for fat metabolism, so they don't produce any ketones in type 2 diabetes, so they do not develop DKA. They do, however, develop a similar life-threatening condition called HHS, which is hyperglycemic hyperosmolar syndrome, and again, you'll talk about that in block 3. Type 2 diabetes has some major risk factors that can be modifiable: hypertension, overweight to obesity, and hypercholesterolemia. We call this cluster of risk factors metabolic syndrome, and in addition to increasing your risk of type 2 diabetes, it also increases your risk of heart disease and stroke. When we assess someone for metabolic syndrome, we have very specific criteria to look at. First is the age, 30 years old or older. Next, we have previously diagnosed blood glucose over 100. Then we have hypertension, which is a blood pressure 130 over 85 or higher, and obesity. Then we also have criteria of hypercholesterolemia, specifically those high density lipids less than 35 or triglycerides greater than 250. If a person has 3 or more of those risk factors, they have metabolic syndrome. Also, for women, having a history of gestational diabetes or having a baby over 9 pounds at birth is a risk factor for metabolic syndrome and type 2 diabetes. And this is the end of part 1 of diabetes.